Welcome, friends. You can all hear me?
Yes.
Welcome to this afternoon session of our three-day program here. I'm very happy to see you again. And I suggested that if you have any questions, I'll take up those questions at this time. And do we have any questions? I understood at least two over there. Who will be reading the questions?
Let me get the other mic.
Is it okay to assume Sadhguru in everyone by pretense, even though one is still on the path but not enlightened yet? Thank you.
I'll read the question again. Is it okay to assume Sadhguru in everyone by pretense, even though one is still on the path but not enlightened yet? It all depends on what you mean by Sadhguru. If by Sadhguru means that do we all have the same capacity to achieve the state of enlightenment that a Sadhguru has, answer is yes. We all have the same capacity. On the other hand, if by Sadhguru we means a master who has come to take us back home, then everybody hasn't come to take us back home. And then we identify one individual. Of course, he's like any other human being, but one individual who appears in our life. We don't search for him, we don't find him. He appears in our life at the right time. And a Sadhguru can be a guru, but may not be a Sadhguru. A guru is a teacher, and especially spiritual teachers have been called gurus. And a guru who comes and teaches us to learn what we have been trying to learn. Supposing we are trying to learn about external things, he is a guru of external things. If you're trying to learn our inside, what is inside us, do heavens and hells exist, a guru will come who has attained that state himself, and he will teach us about that, and that will satisfy us because that is our seeking. And some want to seek, where did the world come from, where did destinies come from, where karma came from? Then, if that is a seeking, a guru will come who will take us to the causal plane. That's what he has attained. For him, that's the final thing, and that's what we are looking for. So guru will teach us that, which means gurus are in several categories. In fact, we also distinguish in the northern Indian states between a Sadhguru and a Sadhguru. Gurus can be any point, but when we say he is a guru of that level, then we start with Sadhguru, who takes us beyond the mind and reveals to us that we are Atma or soul. This is called a Sadhguru. A Sadhguru, in that sense, is one who takes us to our true home, Sat Lok, Sat Khand, that which is the creative power of everything. All things have come from there, including the souls. So that is a different area, but it all depends what we are seeking. A Sadhguru appears in our life if we are seeking our true home and the ultimate truth. If we're seeking anything less, then other gurus come in our life and they teach us that. Or it may happen that we have not fully understood what we are seeking. There are so many people feel that we are seeking something, we don't really know what it is because what we are seeking doesn't fit in with our rational mind, but we are still seeking. In that case, several gurus can come in our life to take us step by step to different places. And as we go to those places, we feel very happy that we have reached that point. But then something tells us, I want more. I think there's something beyond this. I am not fully satisfied. The guru says, I have done my job. Another guru will appear in your life. Another guru appears. So these things happen. I remember this story, and I've told before, but some of you may not have heard it. There was a disciple of great master. His name was Trilokchand. Trilokchand was an engineer in Burma, now called Myanmar. In that country, he worked hard, and he saved a lot of money. He saved money because he was one of those people who think twice before spending. For example, he would hold a 1 rupee note, the currency that was in Burma and India at that time. A currency note of 1 rupee is held in his hand. And he will say, to spend or not to spend. And then he will say, not to spend, and put it in his pocket. So there are some people, you know. So he was that kind. And although he was just an employee of the government working on the roads in Burma, he was a road engineer, he was able to save 30,000 rupees in this spell of a short tenure there. So, but his search for a perfect guru who could take him to his true home was very great. And he heard that in India, in Madras, a city called Madras, now called by a different name, that there is a sadhu, a mystic, who can take you to the highest level of truth. He had tried many sadhus who used to come to Burma, but he left everything. He sold his house, sold everything, put all the money together, 30,000 rupees, and he came to India, to Madras, and he found that sadhu there and said, I understand that you take us to a true home, the highest level. And sadhu said, yes, but I follow a certain principle. He said, what is the principle you follow? He said, I follow Ashtabhakar principle. Now, those of you who haven't heard Ashtabhakar, he was a mystic who gave enlightenment to King Janak. King Janak was a king at that time in India. The old historical facts. So King Janak was looking for truth and ultimately finding what a true home is. Where do we belong? Why are we here? He had some questions. So his ministers and advisors said, King Janak, that's not a big deal. You are living in India. It's full of masters, gurus, yogis, swamis, sadhus, and you can just call all of them together. They would like to attend a yagya or a feast, a holy feast. And they all like good food, especially kheer. I hope you all ate some kheer today. They love rice pudding. And so you just have a big feast. They will all come. And then you can get all the truth you want to know. So he held a big festival. And people from several areas came. And he set them up in small tents in his compound. And then he disguised himself and became incognito as an ordinary person. Like he's also a visitor to see there. He did not tell anybody he was a king. And he went from tent to tent to see where he can find the truth. He was very shocked and surprised that the people who were assembled there were all so full of ego. I know better than you. They were even fighting. Some even came to blows over their knowledge. He said, how can these people be enlightened when they are full of ego? They are still caught up in their mind, and I'm learning nothing from here. They are learned people, but not knowledgeable people. They don't have knowledge, they have learning. They can quote from the books. They all were quoting from the different scriptures. He says, that is not what I am looking for. I am looking for true knowledge, not this kind of learning. So disappointed, he came back to his palace and he called his advisors and ministers, telling them, I am very disappointed. These people are learned, but nobody has the knowledge that I am looking for. And then the minister's advisor said, Your Majesty, you held a very small function. There are so many other enlightened people in this country. You should have a 1 week festival and by beat of drum inform the whole country about your invitation. So he arranged that by beat of drum. The whole country was invited. Whoever can give some enlightenment and knowledge to the king, please join this festival. And many more people came, so the compound was full of many tents, and the feast lasted 7 days. And the king again disguised himself and went from tent to tent, and he saw a repetition of the old thing happening 7 times over. Very disappointed, he said, these people, they claim to be knowledgeable, but they are only memorizing. They are remembering something they have read. They are memorizing something they heard. Where is their knowledge that they can share? So then the minister's advisor said, King, the kind of knowledge you are looking for, these people will not give you. But there is a perfect living master. He doesn't come to these feasts. He sits on the bank of a river, a little hut, and he can give you that knowledge. And his name is Ashtabhakar. Ashta means eight. Ashtabhakar means he had eight, he was a hunchback with 8 folds on his back. So he was a deformed body. Eyes were bright, but the body was deformed. And the king said, why did you tell me first? And he ran to the hut of Ashtabhakar. And Ashtabhakar was surprised to king come with his retinue there. He got up, what can I do for you, your majesty? He said, I have not come as a king. I have come as a seeker and a beggar. I want true knowledge. Ashtabhakar said, certainly. He said, I want you to come to my palace. I'll invite all other seekers and you tell us true knowledge of the self and of God. Ashtabhakar said, I'll certainly come. On the appointed day, Ashtabhakar arrived at the palace and he took off his shoes at the entrance to the auditorium, which is the practice normally done. And he walked with 5 or 6 people behind him. And the king had set up 2 chairs on the stage there, one for himself, one for the master. So he invited the master. He made him sit on 1 chair. The king sat on the other. And king said, I want true knowledge. Ashtabhakar said, there's a price to pay for that. He said, I am willing to pay any price. All my coffers are open, my wealth is open. Ask for anything, I will give you. I want true knowledge. Ashtabhakar said, I want 3 things. The king said, you can have 10, 20, 100. Why only 3? Ashtabhakar said, only 3 things I want. I'll give you true knowledge. Give me your body. Give me your wealth. Give me your mind. I'll give you true knowledge. This was a very strange price tag. He had never thought of it like that. Body, wealth, and mind. He said, Master, my body is at your disposal. All my wealth is yours. My mind is also yours. Now give me true knowledge. Ashtabhakar said, are you sure you have given these to me? Yes, Master. He said, let me start with the body. I can place it wherever I like. Now it's mine. Certainly, Master. Pick up your body and go and place it on the shoes I left at the entrance to this auditorium. Everybody began to laugh and wonder what is happening. This man, crooked man, first came, we laughed at his body. He made a crack, a joke at us that we are leather merchants. He made some joke like that. And now he's asking the king to sit on the shoes. What is this going on? Where is the enlightenment part coming? So as the king walked towards the shoes, all these people were murmuring, what has happened? The king has gone crazy. So king thought, these people don't know what I am looking for. They look at my wealth, that I've got so many palaces, I have so much wealth. They look at my kingdom and they say, why is king doing this? When this thought came to him, Ashtabhakar shouted from the stage, King, you have no business to think of the wealth. It is no longer yours. You already given it to me. Then the king said, I forgot. I had just given all my wealth to Ashtabhakar. Why am I thinking it's mine still? When he thought like that, Ashtabhakar shouted from the stage, King, you have no business to think what you are thinking. You've given your mind also to me. At that time, Ashtabhakar's voice was so strong. King Janak put his hands on his head. I can't even think. And as he did like this, he got enlightened. He tried to give everything. When he gave his thoughts, no thought. Everything is there. He got enlightened. And Ashtabhakar said, no need to go to my shoes, come back. So he came back, said, sit down here. Did you get true knowledge? Yes, Master. Any doubt? No, Master. Any questions? No, Master. He said, do you know I don't need your body? Look at my deformed body, I'm taking care of it myself. I don't need another one. And I don't need the wealth. I'm very happy in my little hut. I certainly don't need your mind. I have a problem with my own mind. I don't need any of these things. I give them back to you. But please remember that although I've given them back to you, remember they belong to Ashtabhakar. Just one thought in your mind. These, my body, my wealth, has been given back to me to use, but it belongs to Ashtabhakar. If you can remember this and deal with your body, your wealth, and your mind as if it belongs to the Master, then with meditation, you'll get the true experience which you just got at a glance, a glimpse of it. You'll get true experience forever within your lifetime. And it'll be within 20 years or so, set a certain time, but not instant. Masters sometimes give us an instant glimpse into something that convinces us there is something there. Doubts are gone. It's a glimpse. And then we meditate. Why can't we get it again? The Master gave a sampling of what you can find. And now you work towards it and go and you'll see it again. So this is very common. This sadhu, this holy man in Madras told Trilokchand, I follow the Ashtabhakar principle. You want true knowledge? Give me your wealth, give me your body, and give me your mind. I'll give you the true knowledge. He said, I am the same. So Trilokchand said, I agree. If King Janak could get it like that, I'll also get it like that. I give you my body, I give you my wealth, I give you my mind. And the sadhu said, let's start with the wealth. How much do you have? He said, I have saved 30,000 rupees, which I brought with me. He said, transfer that into my account. I have to build a temple, and that will be a good start. In those days, it was a big amount. So he transferred the whole money. A man who used to wonder if he can spend 1 rupee, transferred his entire wealth in the name of that sadhu. Sadhu started his temple. He says, now let's go with the body. This body has to be used for meditation. And meditation is not an easy thing. I'll teach you a system of using the body to concentrate your attention on the self through prana. Prana means life, but in this body it means breathing breath of life. Therefore, I will teach you pranayama, which is to control your life with your breathing. And it will be simple. You inhale from one nostril and exhale, same nostril. The next one, inhale from the other nostril and exhale from that, alternately. And it should not be done by using your fingers or hand. If you use your fingers or hand, your attention will go out into your hands. You have to do it internally with the tongue. Tongue is still inside. So you should put your tongue back and from inside in the nostril, alternate it from inside. He says, for this, you have to cut the tendons that hold your tongue down and release it so it can turn backwards. And the sadhu said, I got it done, see? And he stretched his tongue like a snake's tongue. He said, this is how you have to do it. And I will do the surgery to cut the tendons in a painful process, because pain is necessary as a sacrifice to your master. And you have sacrificed your money, now to sacrifice the body, I will inflict pain by rubbing sand, almost sanding, with a very sharp plant, nettle plant, something like Vishwabhuti, they call it. That is a very painful thing that hurts you. I'll do that every day, make you cry and be in pain till it is separated. Trilokchand underwent this torture for a whole month in his search for truth. When the tongue was separated, he said, now give me your mind. There's a third part, that I will teach you what to think and what not to think. Then he taught him some mantras, that the mantras should be repeated at different times and entirely concentrate with the breathing inside. So he tried, and he saw some lights and he saw some calmness that would come. But he said, I want more. I want to know the answers to my fundamental questions. Why is this happening to me? Why am I here? Those answers have not come by this. I'm getting some experiences, but so what? I could go big show outside, have experiences. I'm having some inner experiences, but that's not what I came to you for. And the sadhu said, sorry, that's all I can give you. That's all I learned. If your search is for more than that, another master will come into your life. Eventually, in a search for somebody who can teach him, he by accident came to great master and was initiated by him. And the conversation he had with the great master one evening, great master used to invite some of us just for having dinner or something, or just sitting for chatting for a little while. I'm talking of the 40s, very long ago. I used to bring a small transistor radio that had just come for the first time, so that I could play and the great master would hear the news of the war that was going on and things like that. So that's why I was there. And Trilokchand told the great master, Master, you have shown me the real truth. I remember that conversation. Master, you have given me the truth. Had I known that I have to come to you for this truth, I would not have given those 30,000 rupees to that sadhu there. And great master laughed. And he said, Trilokchand, you don't know. The day you came to me, I transferred those 30,000 rupees to my account. And then he talked to us who were present. He says, when we go to a master and we don't reach where we want to reach, we have worked hard for it, and we think now we wasted our time and now we found a real master, you have wasted no time at all. All that you have done counts for it. And when you go finally to the perfect living master, everything you have done before counts in that account. We don't go to our ultimate destination in one single leap. Our life is not built up like that. We go in stages. We go in stages in this life. We grow up stages like a baby, then we're a child, and so everything is growth here. Everything is evolution. So even this, our journey toward our true home goes in different steps till we find a Satguru, a perfect living master who takes us finally, and he's taking into account all that we have done in our journeys before. This information that he shared with the Trilokchand and with us, I felt it was for me. Because at that time, now I'm telling you something very personal. At that time, I was in full doubt about the master. I felt that I have been born in a family where my father is following him. And simply because my father followed him, I'm growing up believing he is a master. And this came, this reaction came to me very early. It came to me about a few years, I was still very young. And when the master initiated me young, I still had my doubts. A lot of doubts. I said, maybe these masters are making up nice stories, there's a big business going on. Where's the proof? I wanted proof. And I said, there is no proof here. Therefore, I'll try everything else. Maybe truth lies somewhere else. I've just happened to following a particular man, a white-bearded man, thinking he's a perfect living master. How do I know? Maybe I'll find a better master. So I spent several years in my college days, high school days, college days, searching for several yogis, swamis, sadhus, whoever I could meet. So because I was going all over doing lots of things, that particular event with the Lokchan eventually made me feel and now know nothing of my time was ever wasted or lost. It was necessary for me to go through all that. Another incidental benefit came to me by going there. Now, at this age of mine, I'm 91, over 91. I can look back now in my life. I'm not beginning of life that I have to see what will happen in the future. Now, at this stage, I have to see what happened in the past. How did I come up to this point? I now realize that when I met those yogis, when I practice yoga of various kinds, today I meet people who ask me about the very thing they are doing. And I have answers based not on theoretical books or something, that I did the same thing. So my answers become more practical for them. And this is something very important I learned, that if you have not practiced something, you cannot give a convincing answer to anybody. You give an answer from a book, it never goes into the heart of a person. You give an answer from your own experience, it goes into the heart of a person. I heard the story of a master, a holy man, who was well known for his effect on the children. Whatever is said to a child, the child would listen. Child would not listen to the parents, would listen to their holy man. He had that reputation. One mother, whose child was eating too much of sweets, and she could not control, she would hide the sugar, hide the sweet, he would still find it and eat. So he got skin problems and problems with the eating too much sugar. She said, I'll take this boy to that holy man. If he says stop sugar, my boy will stop sugar. That faith. She took the boy to the holy man and said, he eats too many candies. Can you tell him not to? Holy man looked at him, said, bring him after 1 week. So they went back. After 1 week, they went back. Holy man said to the child, child, don't eat candies. The child stopped eating candies. Mother was curious, if this is all he had to say, why did he wait for 1 week? So she went back to him and said, holy man, you told my son not to eat candies. He doesn't eat candies. But why did you make me wait for 1 week to bring him again? He said, the truth is, when you first brought him, I ate candies. If I eat candies and tell the child not to eat candies, it won't have any effect. I stopped eating candies for 1 week to be able to tell your son, don't eat candies, it worked. That is why it's so important that unless you experience something yourself, your answer don't go into the heart of a person. If it's your experience from where you speak, it goes into the heart of a person. And when I now have friends all over the world talking to me about their experiences in yoga, experiences, different kind of masters, different kind of practices, I suddenly remember I did all that myself. And what happened to me with that relates to the question they are asking, and I can answer it more effectively. So this is very important. That is why you will notice when I come and talk to you or I answer your questions, whether in personal meetings or in an audience like this, I do not answer from any books. In fact, I didn't read too many books. And somehow an idea came to me that books might mess up my mind. Everything has messed up my mind, but books will add to it. I had to read books, spiritual books particularly. Other books I had to read to pass examination, just to memorize them. But spiritual books I would not read. I said practice rather than read books. If you practice, then you don't need to read the books. You'll find out what the books are talking about. I came to this country, United States, in 1962 for a fellowship to study at Harvard University, got a fellowship. And I met many disciples of masters, satsangis, of different masters. And they were reading books. I made a statement to them in one of the meetings that unless you first sit at the third eye center, you should not even begin meditation. Because if you don't do that, your mind will always be connected with where you are sitting, what you are doing. It won't go in. Simple statement. I also told them that you set up a special place in your house. People buy a special small rug, carpet to meditate on. I said, if you buy something special to meditate on, you'll be meditating on that thing, not on yourself. People set up a corner in their house. It's my temple where I worship God, and I made it very nice. I have candles and I have those incense burning and I have this thing. If that is special for you, your attention is special for them, for these things that happen. It doesn't go inside. It remains what you've done special. People get a special chair. This is my chair. They take me. Okay, I have a special chair for meditation. You sit on it, you'll also get benefit. I also go and sit on it. And I say, where is the benefit? It's a good chair. I can say it's a very comfortable chair. But this is nothing to do with what is the third eye center inside. Attention is being drawn because I made it special. Supposing I sat anywhere and put my attention there, there's nothing to draw it outside. But if I make things special for the sake of spiritual practice, so I said, this is very important. Ignore outside things. Just make your chair an imaginary chair, third eye center, and sit on it, then start meditation. Have a nice carpet, free of cost, through your imagination, third eye center, and sit on it and meditate. Whatever you want to use, create it there with your imagination, then use it. They said, what you're saying doesn't make sense. I said, why? We haven't read it in any books. I said, I don't know, I haven't read any books at all, so I don't know about the books. I'm talking you what I experienced, what great master taught. Do you have any book of great master teachings? Oh yes, we have a book called The Spiritual Gems. Spiritual gems are letters written by a great master to his disciples in America. I said, do you have a copy? I've never read it. I'd like to see it. So they brought a copy of Spiritual Gems. I sat all night reading that. Beautiful letters he had written. Very touched. I had tears in my eyes when I read those letters he wrote to people. And every letter that came where he said, you must sit on the third eye center before meditation, I marked. And I marked 16 letters like that in that book. I took it back next day. I said, my friends, you say it's in no books what I'm saying. This book has the same thing 16 times. In those letters. We don't read. Our mind reads a book what it wants to read, not what is in the book. There was another friend of mine when I was at in Cambridge at Harvard. He was also a great seeker. And he came and told me, he said, you know, somebody gave me a book to follow the path. I said, which book did he give you? Oh, written by an American named Julian Johnson. Well, just a useless book. I said, why? Why useless book? He's just gone to India and picked up some odd ideas about these things and writing nothing rational at all. He's so affected by some masters in India, and what he's writing doesn't make any sense to me at all. And I said, what did you do then? He said, I read the book, but I threw it away. It's no use. I said, I'm sorry to hear that the book didn't help you, but sometimes the books help, sometimes they don't. It all depends. I had come much later, many years later, I came to the United States, and he said, I want to see you. I said, I'd like, love to see you come. We'll have dinner somewhere in New York City. He came. He said, I'm on the path. I got initiated. I said, well, how did you find that? I read that book. Which one? The Path of the Masters by Julian Johnson, which I had thrown away. He said, the book means so much, it means the real things. Same book, in 6 years, changed its contents altogether. The prints were the same, words were the same. But what one reads with so much bias inside the head that we just want to read and accept what is fitting in with our mind. We don't read everything, nor do we hear everything, by the way. Now, supposing you go and ask, what did I say today? You give different answers to each other. An example. Not only that, our mind is so constructed that we cannot fully grasp something, but we grasp where we can say, yes, I know. People ask me questions, I know the answers already with them. How do I know it? Because when I give an answer, they say, yes, that's right. That means they knew the answer. That's why they're saying that's right. Supposing I gave a foolish, stupid answer, no. Then it's not my answer they're looking for, they're looking for their own answer, which is already in their mind. Mind functions like that. And that is why we learn things over time, and nothing teaches us better than personal experience. Personal experience explains what the books are. You read a book and you interpret it in many ways. Could it be this? Could it mean that? I see people reading spiritual books and trying to interpret it. Maybe this meant this, maybe it meant that. How can it mean too many things? You have an inner experience, read the book, you know exactly what it means. So experience should be preceding reading of books. Anyway, I became educated and learned after coming to America by reading spiritual books. But nothing gave anything extra from the books. They just made me know that what experience gives us has also been recorded. But you fully understand it if you have the experience, then read it and see what it is. Makes much sense. So when we talk of different gurus, we all have the capacity to be the same as a perfect living master. Same as any Satguru, we all have the same capacity. Our creative power has granted everything to all of us. It can be accessed by anybody, anywhere in the world, and can be done by his child, adult, old man, woman, or even in between, or whatever. Anybody can have that access, and it's all inside. Same. Not that a master comes to put something in our head and say, find it. It's already there. Great master used to say, there are people who are, they have some instrument to see where there's a well, water underground. You dig and the well comes out. So they have a capacity to find out where a well is. And we use them in India to find out, is this land barren? Can you tell us which is a good place to dig? They didn't have all the instruments which can now be used by science, but they used to have these people. And they are divine people who would go and say, dig here, you'll get a well. When they dig, the water is there. It does not mean that they have placed a well there for you to dig. Well is there. They know where it is. Masters are like that. They tell us where it is. They accompany us to show you where it is. They dig the well for us. But the well is already there. They don't place it there. Now that is why the Satgurus that we want to meet, seek for the truth, Satguru will appear in your life. They say when a chela is ready, Guru appears. They don't say when chela is ready, he can find a Guru. And a chela is ready, when a disciple is ready, a master appears. How does he appear? By coincidence, by circumstances. Now, why is coincidence important? Because coincidence is something happening differently than the law of probability indicates. This world is running on mathematical laws. One of the mathematical laws which has been confirmed over and over again is the law of probability. Probably this will happen. A coincidence is against the law of probability. It was not supposed to happen, it happened. How come I opened the page of a book at random? It was something else about another subject. First line, answered my question I had asked yesterday to my own self. How come I'm thinking of a subject, driving my car, and there's an advertisement, an ad on a hoarding somewhere for some other object, but one line fits in exactly with my question. It's very unlikely, improbable, but when that happens, we call it a great coincidence. So coincidences take place when we find a perfect living master, a Satguru in our life. And coincidences increase as we go into meditation. That's another thing. That when you start meditating inside, you'll see more and more coincidences happening. Ultimately, you'll find that the whole programming is set up for creation on that basis. But that requires you to go several layers higher to find that out. So it is when you say, then the questioner asks, do we see Sadhguru in everybody? Potentially there in everybody, but the Sadhguru that will take you to your true home appears as a human being, singular, one person comes into your life. Sorry for giving a very long answer, but it's interesting.
Everyone that I talk to seems to remember initiation so well. You remember initiation very clearly. Why can I not remember my initiation clearly like everybody else? Thank
you. Everyone that I talk to seems to remember initiation so well. You remember initiation very clearly. Why can I not remember my initiation clearly like everybody else? Initiation is not for remembering. Initiation is for practice. If you practice, you won't forget it. You don't have to remember initiation. You have to practice it. If you don't practice something, you'll forget it. So when everybody remembers initiation, they like to make use of it and see what we can do with initiation. Therefore, the way to remember initiation is to practice it every day. I want to emphasize this point. If you do meditation, you should do it every day. Not every weekend. Not once a month. Don't say, I am so busy with my work, I get up early morning, rush to work, and I can't do any meditation during the weekdays because I'm working. On weekends, I can give 5 hours. 5 hours will not catch up with the days we have missed. There is, like most other things that we do, a momentum created when we do something regularly. If you cannot find 2 hours, 2.5 hours, you can find half an hour. If you can't find half an hour, you can find 10 minutes. If you can't find 10 minutes, you can find 5 minutes. And the morning you get up your 5 minutes to devote to meditation, the day will go well. And you will never forget initiation. But if you say, years have passed, I get emails, I was initiated 40 years ago. But somehow, I didn't get anything, so I gave it up. After 40 years, I'm suddenly remembering it. Just because I saw you on YouTube. I said, thank you to YouTube then. At least it made you remember something after 40 years and you had forgotten even about initiation. No, initiation is not for remembering. Initiation is for practice. Initiation is a practical way to verify and validate the statement you hear in satsangs and from spiritual people. They tell you there's a true home. How do you know? Well, they say go in and see it. They don't say, okay, believe me. Religion says, believe me. All religions say, believe us. Somebody said something who is not living today. They say, believe him. It happened long ago, but believe it. All based upon a belief, not on experience. Santmat, the path of the masters, depends upon experience, not on belief. Believe what you experience. And then that belief that you experience will never go away. Doesn't matter how much time passes, because your own experience, and every day you build more and more on that experience. That is why you don't forget initiation, you just practice it, you will never forget it. Any more questions?
When I meditate, what are some ways I can encourage love to flow?
When I meditate, what are some ways I can encourage love to flow? Well, you can encourage by having conversation with your beloved master. If you are not feeling a pull of love from your master, you are at a very early stage, and maybe that's not your master at all. Somebody asked me, give us a very clear definition. How can we know a particular person is really a master and really my master? I said, the best indication is that person will pull you, which is love, and you will see if you associate with a person, his love is unconditional and there's no expectation, no judgment about what you are or what you're doing. He'll only respond to your seeking and that love will pull you. If it doesn't pull, I'm not your master. It's as simple as that. I am not giving any certain qualifications. A perfect living master never charges money for his teachings, which is true. But there are so many people who can stop charging money for their teachings. He doesn't qualify one to be a master. A perfect living master doesn't perform public miracles, he performs private miracles. People who have done a simple yoga of the lower centers of energy can do that. That's not somebody taking your true home, they're just taking you to energy centers which are just below serving you, serving your experience in life. Similarly, these people define them in different ways. But I say if a perfect living master has pulled a person A and not pulled a person B, B should not follow that master because A is following. He must feel that pull. Supposing his time is not right. These things happen in our time because of our karmic pattern we carry with us from previous lives. Supposing the time is not right, we'll not feel today. On the day, we'll feel right. We'll feel the pull. So there's a timing for that. And does not mean just because somebody else is doing it, I am also doing it. We call it bhed chal, following like sheep. This is not a path for that. It's an individual path. And the individual experience must be there. So that is why when the pull is there, your response, you talk to the master. One of the biggest factors is to experience gratitude. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Every little thing happens in your life which you feel master's hand in it, thank you, thank you. Do you know when you start noticing the good things that are happening in your life, after especially you meet a master, there'll be so many things you will know which are different. Probability again doesn't allow that. And those will happen, you say, master's hand, otherwise I would have been hit by a car, he just saved me at one moment, I would never have done this. Sometimes very small things. I'm going to attend a master satsang. Cars are all over the place. And I can't reach in time. And suddenly a car moves away and I get ahead of others. No parking spot is there. Suddenly one car pulls out. How is all this happening? They're very minor things. But they're coincidences. And you say, thank you, Master. Thank you, Master. We say all the time. The more gratitude you express, you're expressing your devotion for the love you're experiencing. So love and devotion grows with a conversation with your master, with gratitude and thanks and appreciating whatever master is giving us. That's very important. Of course, it reminds me of a joke. You don't mind hearing a joke? Some people say, why do you tell jokes in your serious talks? I said, because I'm not a master, I'm a joker. Maybe. But the joke I remembered is from a book I read, of course these are for books. There was an Irish man. His Irish people, you know, they love to have their whiskey at a pub. An Irish man had to attend a conference and there was no parking spot in the outside the conference hall. So he prayed to God. God, please find one parking spot for me today. I will stop drinking whiskey and I will go to church every Sunday from now. And a car pulled out. And he said, I found one. No bother now. Just a joke about a parking lot. We can say, Master, give me a parking lot. No, now I know, not necessary for you to intervene. I got one. Thank you very much.
Does eating eggs go against the vegetarian diet?
Does eating eggs go against the vegetarian diet? Yes, it does. Because it's a form of life that matters. It's not the life that matters, it's the form of life that matters. And eggs delivered by roosters, hens, these hens' eggs are designed, laid for producing more chicks. The fact that they are fertilized or not fertilized, which is an issue that is brought up to me again and again. The eggs I eat are unfertilized. I said, my friend eats a chicken in the refrigerator, which is also dead. No life. There's no difference. Why do you think there's a difference? If it is no life in it, the dead chicken has no life, dead lamb has no life, dead cow has no life. Actually, I'll tell you, His Holiness Dalai Lama, a spiritual guy, came to India as a refugee. He had to escape because the Chinese were appointing a Chinese governor in Lhasa, capital of Tibet. As it happened, I was working for the government in India and in charge of a district as a district commissioner, deputy commissioner or district collector of a district, Dharamsala, in Punjab at that time, in now Himachal Pradesh. And it was my duty to receive him and to take care of him. So I met him. I was told to be incognito, in disguise, like an ordinary person when he arrived. So I could see how he lives, who comes with him. His sister came with him. Two tutors came with him who were teaching him meditation. So I met all their group. They housed him in a small hill station for a little while. And then when I was able to, I and my wife were preparing his house. We acquired rented houses in Upper Dharamsala and we brought him over and housed him. I used to have a Land Rover given to me by the government for my job, and he would love to ride with me sometimes. So as we used to ride, he began to learn a little bit of my language, English language. Otherwise, he used to speak through interpreter, Boti language or Tibetan language. So as we began to compare notes, I began to say, and he was doing a lot of meditation, 8 hours a day, under the instructions of his two tutors. But they were eating meat. And I said, your meditation will improve if you don't eat meat. He asked me the reasons. I gave the reasons. Main reason is that when you eat food, you may not know, your subconscious knows where it's come from. And if it is created by pulling out of a plant or by killing an animal, that memory is there in what you're eating. You may not at that time be fully aware because it's in the subconscious mind that you know where it's coming from. So I said, it affects you. Buddha, whom you follow, said, thou shalt not kill. One of his commandments. And I said to Dalai Lama, you follow Buddha, he says, thou shalt not kill. His argument was, I don't kill. Somebody else kills. I eat what somebody else kills. Supposing there's a karma involved, it'll go to that guy who's killing. He's not following Buddha's instructions. I'm eating what is already dead and killed. And I said, but do you know that this image, internal image of somebody killing an animal is carried by the food when you eat? You may not directly know it, but if you want to see killing once, you will always see it in that food. See it just once, and you will always see the killing in the meat when you eat every time. So it's not the question of whether you're seeing killing or you're killing yourself or not. It's associated with the food. I tried many arguments. He said, no, I don't kill. Then I gave him the final argument. Why don't you try meditation for 1 month on pure vegetarian meals? Not even eggs, because eggs are also extinguishing the life of what is meant for a life form. Even if it is unfertilized, it's still meant for a purpose. The purpose of the egg is to form a chicken. The purpose is still there. Even if it is killed, not fertilized, it's still an egg. An egg is an egg. See its effect on the mind in power of concentration. And I explained what concentration is. Supposing we want to read a book. We have a normal rate at which we read the book. Somebody reads fast, somebody reads slow. But we all have a particular normal typed pages. 1 minute a page or half a minute a page. Okay. You go kill a man and try to read it. You won't be able to read the book. Take a long time to read that one page. You can't get that out of your mind for concentrating your attention on something else. You kill an animal, it will be less recovery time than killing a man. Still be there, delay will be there. Even if you eat a vegetable, it's still there, but it's very minor. You can't notice it. Life subsists on life. Nobody lives on stones. Even we eat vegetables, vegetables also have life. But the life is in different degrees of awareness. And those awarenesses create different effects or a power of concentration. So I explained all this. But I said the final argument is test. He tested meditation. 1 month vegetarian, 1 month non, became a vegetarian. It's a very interesting thing. And only on that basis. I was then later on posted in Chandigarh as chief secretary of state at that time, and he had coming from Europe, and he got sick in Europe, and in Zurich they served him some meat soup or something. So he came to tell me that something happened, it was just not in my control, it happened like that. So maybe when I am in the control of these people, I can't always control what I eat. Some may be brought to me, my notice. But I'm only mentioning to you, ultimately the proof of the pudding is lying in the experience. You try your meditation with meat, try your meditation with vegetarian food, and you'll find the difference yourself. Try your meditation with fertilized or unfertilized eggs, try without them, you'll find the difference. So that is why, to get the best advantage, to make meditation effective, avoid eating eggs of any kind. If you don't want an effective meditation, just a belief system, like many people make santmat, path of the master into a religion. They follow one religion, they leave it, they say, now we are following this religion called santmat. We used to be following one temple, now we follow this one. There is no difference in that. You are following a temple, you are following rituals, you are not following the real temple, which is the human body. Go inside here. That's the real temple. You find reality in this temple, nowhere else. They're all made by us. This is made by the Creator. So that is why avoid eggs also along with meat if you want to have effective meditation. This is from practical point of view. Okay, one more question.
Please speak about...
I have a fancy watch I keep on seeing. You might also have a look. Sometimes tendency to show off hasn't gone away in me.
Please speak about worrying. How to break this habit.
You might think that I look at the watch for time, it's blank every time. I have to calculate the time myself. Please speak about worrying, how to break this habit. We worry too much. There is a church in Rochester, Minnesota, and we happened to go to the church, and there was a notice on the church. It said, worrying is praying for failure. Very good. When you worry, you are praying, I want to fail. That's what worry does to us. Worrying is not praying for success. Making plan for moving forward, actually moving forward, is for success. Worrying is to go backwards and move away from success of any kind, spiritual or worldly. Worrying doesn't solve any problem at all. The biggest thing I've seen about worry is we worry about things that are irrelevant and don't even occur in our life. We worry this can happen, that can happen. They never happen. We worry 10 times more than if worry was really necessary. Supposing we are coming across a problem we have to solve, worrying about it will not solve it. A different word for that called concern. You are concerned about it and you take measures to meet that concern and solve the problem. To do that helps you. But to worry, oh, I should have done differently. Most of the worry is about the past. Most of the worry is how I could have done things differently. Let me tell you, you couldn't have done differently. It looks to you now, you'll do it differently. If you are placed right now in time back at the point, you do the same thing all over again. This hindsight knowledge comes only when the time has passed, we have done something. No, I could have done it differently. You couldn't have done it differently. the set of circumstances, the knowledge you had, the data you had at that time made you act in that way, you'll do it again. If what you've now learned does not change what you could have done earlier. And that is why worry is useless. What we have to remember, there are four principles on which Indian spirituality used to fall back for living life. One was, you do not meet anybody in life without any purpose. Either you meet to learn something or to teach something. Every person you come close to in life, there is a purpose behind it. It's not a useless thing that, and when that purpose is done, that person disappears. You don't see him again. Second principle is that things will happen exactly at the time they are supposed to happen, neither before nor later. That's how karma works, that's how destiny works. Therefore, trying to push things, I don't want to do it quickly. Oh, I could have done it quickly. Doesn't work. Never happens like that. So, and the most important principle is whatever has happened and gone. They say whatever is over is over. Don't carry it with you. When you carry the past with you, you are creating unnecessary worry. You don't need to worry. If you want to give up worrying, first step is to stop thinking of what happened earlier. Think of what can happen in the future. And as I said in the morning, when you have to learn some lesson from the past, you learn it anyway. It remains with you. Whether you worry or not worry, the lesson is with you. Worrying doesn't add to the lesson. Worry only complicates your lesson. So that is why forget the past. Live in the future. Make fantastic plans. I mentioned in the morning that there are two wills we have. A mental will and a spiritual will. Mental will is guided by thoughts. You think, this is good for me. This is what I should be doing. By thought you come to a decision. And that mental will, you can exercise and do it. We don't always do it. We don't use mental will. How many of you, tell me honestly, have decided in your life, I will never do this again, and you still did it? See? Here it is. We all have gone through that experience. We lack mental will. There's no spiritual will involved in that. It's our own mind's decision. I will not do that again, we still do it. We have to strengthen our mental will to be able to stick to what we decide. Worry will go away. Then there is spiritual will. Spiritual will is built upon our intuition, not on the thinking. Spiritual will comes when an intuitive thought comes and we give it up because the mind says something different. No, stick to spiritual will and things will go right. What we say, oh, I knew this will go wrong. I still did it. If you didn't know you did wrong, it's all right. How could you do wrong when you knew it is not to be done? Because the knowing came from intuition and your reason said, no, don't worry about it, just a superstition, do it. Change your life and try it out. If not your whole life, try for a few months that you put your intuition for decision making and mental will for carrying it out. Your life will change and become much better life. I told this to some friends of mine. I said, try it. They were very happy. Their life changed. They came back to me. They said, you said that our destiny is fixed. You said everything is already fixed. And now you taught us a way by which we have changed our life. Then how is destiny fixed? I said, I was destined to tell you this. And you were destined to follow it. Destiny has not changed. This is also true when we say miracles happen. A person is going through a hard life, hard part of life, and goes to his master, goes to a holy person, goes to somebody with divine intervention. Please give divine intervention. He says, all right. I will do some mantra for you. I will do some holy thing for you, and you will be saved. And you are saved. You go give a lot of wealth, give us prasad, whatever you like to give to thank that person. Your divine interventions saved me from a very bad situation. But then you say, if the divine intervention had not taken place, I wouldn't have been saved. Then you meditate and go to the astral plane where you can see the future. You say, let me see the past and future of that event that happened. Then you find at that right time, this will come as part of a predetermined future. The divine intervention was nothing new. It was part of the intervention already recorded at that time. That means it wasn't real divine intervention at this level. It was already written like that. It will happen like this. So you now ask your master at that level, please now change it. That will be change of my destiny. Master says, okay, changed. And now this is real change. Because now I can see the future changed. I saw the future, and I saw the future changing. This is real divine intervention. You go to the next causal plane and find out that you asked for the master to change. It was changed millions of years earlier. When destiny was made, it was already, the second change was also there. Okay, let me try now. Now everything is being made there. The whole karma is being made there. Master changed the whole karma. Okay, whole karma changed. New birth, new everything has happened. At all levels below. Now at least this is a real change. And you go to a true home, the whole thing was already pre-programmed by yourself. Then that's very big news. That this is just the levels of consciousness, levels of awareness that make us feel these changes. What is the lesson we can draw from that? Lesson is not, let's do nothing. Because if you do nothing, then that's what is written. And if you do something, that's also written. Lesson is, do your best. If divine intervention is possible, get it. If you can pray for something good, do it. Because whatever you will do is what is pre-written. And the motivation for doing it is pre-written. Sometimes we think only the events are pre-written, not our thoughts. All thoughts are pre-written also. How we will think and how we will decide things is also pre-written. So this destiny is a very strange thing. But you can understand it just going two steps to the causal plane, how destinies are created, how you pick up your destiny, and how you play it out here. It's almost like picking out a DVD and playing it and becoming a part of it. It's interesting. This life is a show, drama. It doesn't look like a drama, because when we see drama, we see it on a stage. We are the audience. We watch from an audience a movie, a drama, different from us. That's what our nature of understanding a drama is. How can this be drama when we are involved in it? No, it's still a drama. One difference only. Difference is you have decided before the play started to make it more interesting instead of watching from an outside place to go and sit inside the one character. Any character. You go and sit inside the head of one character at the third eye center and then watch the drama. And drama becomes very interesting because you begin to believe you are that character. You're not. You just happen to decide that I will watch this show by sitting inside one head. That will be, I'll be very close to the show. That's what we did. It does not mean that we are the person which we are sitting. That's just an actor. Now, supposing this truth I am sharing with you is kept in mind by us, that we are watching this show from a nice seat, comfortable seat, like in a theater, like in a movie theater. He sits it comfortable, murders are taking place, illness are taking place, things are taking place on the stage. We don't run to do anything. It's just a show, it's a movie. Like that, you sit inside on a comfortable chair and watch the show, including the actor, which is your body. Don't think you are the body. Then you won't see the show. If you think you are the body, then you are part of the show. Then you are not watching, not audience. But if you can place yourself there, and meditation helps a lot in that, if you can place yourself there, then look at the world, it will become a show for you. It has a very deep implication if you can watch the show instead of being a participant in the show. Try it out and see the difference of your experience. This body will still go through that thing, but your experience will be totally different, even of this destiny and our life. Thank you very much for listening to me, and I'll take up more questions tomorrow. I'll break now so that I can give some time to those who have asked for a personal few minutes. Since time is short and the number of people who want that is large, I hope you'll be happy if I can just give a couple of minutes. Ask the most important thing that's in your mind. Those who have asked for time, ask the most important thing. Don't write to me an email afterwards, which I sometimes get. When I was with you, I forgot the most important thing. And now I'm remembering it. Okay, I write to them. Doesn't matter. Now you write by email. I'll give you a reply email. The only thing is I get between 200 and 300 texts and email messages a day. So some are very urgent. I try to give an answer as quickly as I can. Others are stacked. So the stack I pull from the bottom, and some stack is heavy, so it takes time. And then in between the time that I am pulling the stack, I find many others who have found a program in my computer, in the iPhone, which picks up all the others also. I say, I've got a huge stack. I pull out one email written to me 3 months earlier, because that's the turn has come now. Pull it out. 5 others come out, saying, why didn't you reply to me? I sent you earlier. Some of them are very close to each other. They say, I sent you a message yesterday, and I was waiting till 4 o'clock. I wrote to you, I'm waiting till 4 o'clock. Why has no reply come to me? And I'm picking it up, because the question is very general question information. No urgency in it, no connection with the urgency of life. A general question. So it comes up, and I pull the last one, 5 more come out like this. So actually the stack is a little artificially heavy because of so many reminders in it. But certainly, if you forget to ask the most important question in the couple of minutes we have together, then it may take time. I'm just telling you, it may take time to get a reply to the same question. But if you have the most important thing that you want to ask, because time is limited, so please do so. Thank you very much. I'll see you tomorrow, 11 o'clock.